Game On is brought to you by
Winning has never been this simple. Bet with 1xBet.
Game On. It's Game On. We are big on sports. Big on sports.
Alrighty, still Game On, of course, proudly brought to you by 1xBet. You can actually go online on 1xbet.ug, jump onto anything, whether it's football, whether it's cycling, boxing, name it all. We the best rats, betting rats, rather, I beg your pardon. You can, of course, find yourself onto, and you never know, you could be one of those lucky winners. Strictly for persons under 18. It can be strictly very harmful and very addictive. Brian, do you bet by any chance?
I'll tell you something quickly. When I first started doing radio, my first show on radio was sponsored by a betting company. Mm-hmm. And to kick us off, they gave me some, I don't know if it's called float or something, to just start betting. Mm-hmm. And I placed it once, they took all of it. That was the last time.
Well, I saw you bust laughs when I spoke Rex. It's close to Rex, but you know, I sometimes, you know, skip
English
it out.
Came on the boat.
Yeah, but it's okay. Yeah, fair enough. But of course, let's get into the group stages of the African Cup of Nations. We'll start with Group A, where you have Egypt, who managed to top the pile with 9 points, followed by the Uganda Cranes coming out with 4 points from the three games played out, one win and one draw and one defeat that did come through last night against the Faroes, who managed to finish their campaign on a high. Well, DR Congo bounced back, a lifeline for themselves, having been beaten up by Uganda Cranes and by Egypt, putting 4 goals past the Zimbabwean side, who went back home with nothing but sadness and misery. Well, looking at Group B has, of course, Madagascar surprisingly leading the pile with 7 points, marching into as group winners. As far as the knockout stage gets to go, Nigeria right there with 6 points after yesterday's stunner against the side in Madagascar. Guinea in third place and likely to be among the third place finishers. And of course, Burundi, who came out for the first time in their campaign at the AFCON with nothing but just 0 points from three games played out. Group C did come with Algeria, who are likely to win this one here with a game tonight against the Taifa Stars in Tanzania. They are currently on 6 points, 3 points clear of second place side in Senegal and Kenya. Now, those two will be rubbing shoulders later on tonight in what should be an interesting affair. Then the Tanzanian side, who have nothing to play for, are rock bottom in Group C. Now, Group D comes in Morocco right there with 6 points, likely as well to finish as Group D winners. And behind them is Ivory Coast, the Elephants, who are jointly sharing points with South Africa, that is the Bafana Bafana, and Namibia, also on no points from two games played out. Group C, or rather E, I beg your pardon, has Mali right there with 4 points, Tunisia, and of course Angola with Mauritania. All four sides right there in Mali, Tunisia, and Angola, along with Mauritania, can still qualify, provided that they win the respective games on March Day 3. Now, finally, Group F has Cameroon, Ghana, Benin, and Guinea-Bissau. Again, similar story to Group E, where all four sides can still qualify for the knockout stage, provided that they get to win today's games respectively. Now, quickly, let's look at the third place best finishers. And those, of course, include DR Congo, they include South Africa right there, they include Kenya, they include Guinea as well. All possible entrants into the knockout stage in regards to who does get to finish well today in Group A and in Group F, because then match day three games will be played out today. Now, obviously, we also have some more in there. Angola, including as well in 2 points, a win today will have them secure 5 points and reach the knockout stage. Like I mentioned, South Africa, who also managed to get the job done against Namibia, will have to tussle it out today to get into the knockout stage. Now, those are the possible entrants for the knockout stage. Third placed best finishers. And I would imagine the situation of go out there, avoid panic mode, and try to seal the 3 points going into these games. Now, Kawalia, you've been there before at this stage in terms of playing with pressure and intensity. But for a size like Kenya, but South Africa, obviously, you know, rebuilding in their squad, you'd imagine that they have the right structure and also maybe the right players to actually have them go through this phase of get all 3 points and avoid this, you know, the mathematics of suppose we draw and then the other person wins or loses. Those are the teams that I would imagine that would qualify from this, you know, from this lot.
Yeah, I think there are some teams you have to point out, like Kenya and South Africa, even DR Congo. I think those teams have an advantage of qualifying.
Well, having scored 4 goals, of course.
Yeah, because, you know, for example, when you look at Kenya and South Africa, they are going to play under much pressure, but experience will come in later.
Okay.
Because
experience, you mean?
Exactly. Because right now, what they want is a win. Okay.
Nothing short of that.
Nothing short of that. Because this is their last card now. They are using this game as their last card. So today's game is experience with the determination that give them proper results.
South Africa, do we see them marching to the knockout stage? They've had a very rusty campaign. Stuart Baxter mentioning pedigree and the fact that they need to go out there and play with heart and urgency.
I think South Africa, right from get-go, are arguably the hardest group, because you look at that particular group and you always felt like when they came up against teams like Ivory Coast, they were always going to be made to work for every single result they were taking those particular games. So they've got quite the interesting shout, because what happens is, you know, with the six groups, at least four of the six teams that get to finish third, you know, will be able to progress. So to be safe, if they can hit a margin of, a tally of 4 points, it puts them in a very good place. I look at Guinea as well, they're in the same conversation. For DR Congo, it might be quite the stretch for them to actually get into those top 14. You look at Benin as well, if they take a point in their final game, they'll actually be able to finish as a third place team and probably be able to qualify. So if you look at the permutations, 4 points really, unless otherwise, should be able to see most of these teams progressing as a third.
So how many slots do we have for third?
There are four teams
four
out of the six
required.
Groups.
Well, of course, we do have pretty much like eight teams coming out of fight for only four slots available for a place in the knockout stage in regard to the third best third best placed teams in the knockout stage. Now, quickly, we're going to drive away a little bit from the Nations Cup and talk about the devastating campaign down here in Kampala in Lugogo, where the Silverbacks and the Gazelles failed to qualify for the Zone 5 Championship after bad outing against the Kenyan sides for the Gazelles yesterday. It finished 67-62. Despite Clela Munu's individual brilliancy, the Gazelles of Nicholas Hereza and Ali Mavita failed to get the job done, losing back-to-back against Egypt and yesterday against the Kenyan side. In the AfroChan and AfroBasket preliminaries, quite a very disappointing campaign, especially for the men's team. We talked about how the kind of players they possess, the history behind these players, and even then, something at stake, and that is qualifying for the Zone 5. 2017 or 16, I think, we had the Silvers come out to win the Zone 5. And I thought that was a very convincing performance here against the Rwandese teams, against the Zanzibar teams. Yeah. And moving forward, from what we've seen, this campaign has been quite a different script, even with the big men in there that haven't lived up to the billing.
Yeah, just like you mentioned, big names in there haven't actually lived up to the billing. You look at the Silverbacks, first the men's team, and it's pretty much been about the guy who came in from Spain, that is Brendan Davis. He's played at a whole different level compared to his teammates. Now, in the game that we lost recently, you notice that this time around it was Robinson Odoch who struggled to come up and put up the big shots for the team. Unfortunately, I really feel like the squad has not been as exercised as possible. You'd have thought that for the head coach George and his assistant, that is Mande Jironi, they should have tried out some of these other players. Players like Saras Chiviri in that team, obviously players like Stanley Mugera, Jimmy Enabo as well. Some of these have not been able to get as much playing time as they could have wanted to. And we struggled against teams like, Kenya. We struggled against teams like Egypt. I think in terms of preparations for this tournament, they might have done a better job. For the Gazelles as well, it's been pretty much Clela Munu, the star of the team. Rita Imanishiwe once in a while when she's chosen to show up for the team. But beyond that, we struggled to find players that could play as the unit and come out there and battle for the tournament. So going into the games today, for the Gazelles against Kenya, for the Silverbacks against Rwanda, it's pretty much playing for pride. It's pretty much saving face as the host, you know, giving the fans a bit of a treat, because most of the fans have been loyal right from the kickoff of the tournament last week, because fans kept coming out in huge numbers. They've been cheering the team on. So you need to give them that good performance to sort of close out the tournament, because what happens is our chances of qualifying as good as done. So let's go out there, enjoy the game, and see what happens next.
Of course, you've been part of the national team setup, and every time you have big names in the squad, yourself and the likes of who used to play with you, I mean, at such a very big tournament, you just failed to turn up. Something about you doesn't click, or, you know, something about the squad doesn't tell or leave the story. But in such a scenario, when you have such a squad like the one we have in the basketballing avenue, you'd want to think that big names are required to turn up on big occasions.
Yeah, for sure. Big names are always important on such occasions, and they always boost up the young ones. And see, these supporters come to watch those big names, and I think those big names must at least try to deliver to their best so that the team goes up.
Well, that is the unfortunacy with the Gazelles and the Silverbacks, who lost out in what was, well, a very, very horrific campaign for George Galanopoulos and, of course, for Nick Natuherezza. Later on today, they will be facing Rwanda. You want to think it will be nothing short of just going out there to play for pride. Tanzania will also be facing Egypt in what should be a win for the Egyptian side. Now, quickly, this very Sunday in Busika at the Motorsport Arena, the riders will be back again at it, doing what they love doing best, that is the National Motocross Championship, where, of course, we'll be expecting the big boys, Max Evenepoel, the Allen Brothers and company, to showcase some fine racing in front of, well, I'm expected to have a decent crowd to turn up in Busika. Brian, you and I are very, you know, huge followers of the motocross, and every time we have these events coming through, the numbers do turn up. But the most important thing is the entertainment. The most important thing is getting sporting on talent, but even then, giving something back to the fans.
Yeah, I look at that coaster in Busika, and recently there's been a couple of changes in there. From round four, the weather wasn't the best because we had a bit of the rains in there, and for most of the riders and their machines, they tend to get quite tested when it comes to those kinds of conditions. But the hope is, going into this weekend, the weather will actually be quite clear. Certainly, preparations have been going under. We all know that Busika is the home of motocross when it comes down to the competition. And back to the individuals, you've got Chigundu in there in the MX1, battling it with the main man, Maxime Van Pee, who is the team captain in there. Obviously, for the MX125, you've got the likes of Fortune Center, Aviv Olandi, that one there, the MX85, MX65, with the likes of Gift Sebuguzi. So it promises to be a very interesting one there. And it's pretty much battling for points, get them on board, see if you can lead your different class and see what happens. So expecting a very interesting one there. For most of the fun, the story is about the thrill of the antics, things like the skills that the riders bring on the day. And when it comes to motor sport altogether, it's about the understanding between the rider or the driver and the machine. How all these two come together always produces something phenomenal. So for the different classes, we can't wait and see what we're going to be looking out for.
We've seen a couple of youngsters in there. Obviously, the 50cc young riders. Recently, we had a big man from the army talking about how he was actually in disbelief that these young ones can go out there and race in the manner in which they do race. But if you had a son, maybe you do, don't know about your children, but if you had your son, would you have him go out there and venture in such a sport? Because time and again, we worry about them falling off the bikes, breaking an arm or a leg. Would you risk it to actually have your son go out there and have some fun?
Yeah, for sure, why not? Because in every sport, there must be risks. You must take risks in every sport. For example, when you look at football, there are so many risks. Every sport has a risk to take. So if I had a son, I'd let him go and enjoy that game. Why not?
Right. This very Sunday, it is 7th July 2019, the National Motocross Championship will be coming your way down in Busika via the Busika Motocross Arena. Now, quickly, let's now jump into the FIFA Women's World Cup down, of course, in France, where it was about the last eight, now it's about the last four, whereby USA, the cup holders, continue to impress and pursue for the title defense after a slim victory against the host nation in France, who left it late to pull one back thanks to Wendy Renard. And it was a little too late as the hosts in USA managed to reach the semi-finals to set up a date against England. Now, quickly, Germany, the two-time champions, were a standby side in Sweden, who, by the way, will be up against the Dutch ladies, who managed to go past the Italianos. Now, Brian, when you look at that game, the manner in which Sweden fought back came from a goal down to see out the side in